Hello students, welcome for the history class. Today we are going to do the second chapter of your history. Okay, in this we are going to read about the life related to the writing and the city. Okay, so if you have remembered, we have talked about the early humans and their stages. In that we have also talked about the life structure they have adopted till the end of that chapter. Okay, so before we go in, before we start with this chapter, we should remember the important point of the early humans, that before they settled at one place, they have adopted many things. Means they have started with the agriculture, and second, very important, they have started using the life using of fire, and even the needy items which make them their life comfortable. So we have talked about the settlement and how they have discovered the societies. Okay, so this chapter will be giving us more information about their city or their settled life. Okay, when we talk about the second chapter, the name of this chapter is life writing and city life. When we talk in this chapter, we will be mainly talking about Mesopotamia. Okay, Mesopotamia, the word that means the middle land which is between two rivers. Correct. So when we talk about Mesopotamia, it is a word that derived from the Greek word meso, which means middle, and potamos, which means river. So this city, okay, in which we will be having a great development period, we will be reading in this chapter. So this chapter, this Mesopotamia, it's a very big city, we can say, or a developed city that was between the two rivers. Okay, so what that river is, the name of that river is Euphrates and the Tigris rivers. So this two rivers, now we can see in the Republic of Iran. Okay, before we move with the explanations, I will make it clear, more clear with the map. You can see in the map, these are the two rivers. Here it is the one river, Euphrates, and there is the Tigris. So between these two rivers, the Mesopotamian city was there. Okay, so we will be having a complete explanation of these areas. Here you can see the some cities name, that is Babylon, Ur, Mari, okay, then Ur. These are some of the cities. Again, I'm repeating, these four cities which you can see on the river sides, they are Mari, Babylon, Urk, and Ur. Correct. So you can see, when we talk about this complete land, it is mainly surrounded by the sea. One side you can see the Red Sea. This is Persian Gulf. When this when the land shows like this, when water enters into the land body and there is a very less place between the land, and they occupy the major area of land that is known as the Gulf. Okay, here you can see the upside, that is the Caspian Sea, and on the northern side there is again Black Sea, and at the western side you can see Mediterranean Sea. Okay, so that is giving the correct location of Mesopotamian city. Okay, and below you can see we are having a great deserts of Africa. Here it is completely Iran, Iraq, and Saudi Arab countries. Okay, so these are the countries linked with the, these areas are Turkey and Syria. Correct. So I hope you understood the location of this. See, India is here. Okay, this is the Indus River. So India's location is here. So when we talk about the Mesopotamian, it is between the two rivers. So that land which is between the two rivers is known as the Mesopotamia. So let's read and do understand the content of the chapter. Okay, so I hope you understood this is the land at present in the Iraq. So when we talk about the Mesopotamians, it is a great civilization. Civilization period, when we have read about the Indus Valley civilization, Harappan civilization about India, it was a great civilization in the world. That is the Mesopotamian civilization. Civilization is a period when we talk about a great societies come together and they show some development infrastructure in their areas and they had a good connectivity with the world. Okay, so when we talk about this Mesopotamian city, it was a prosperous city and it had a city life, correct? So prosperous means it is having a good luxurious, or we can say have a good life supporting elements that is available in the Mesopotamia. And it's voluminous and rich literature, correct? So this Mesopotamian had its rich literature and its mathematics and astronomy. So we can consider this is not a small city we are talking about. It is a very big city having a great or a rich literature. And we can see a major developments in the field of mathematics and astronomy. Okay, so Mesopotamian's writing system is and literature spread in the eastern meridian, north Syria, Turkey. Okay, I will not show you the map again and again. By the map you have understood it has covered the northeastern states, means the writing spread to all of the Syrias and Turkeys, means how many years before we at, when we talk about this time, so it was around 12 or more than 50,000 years before. So it has after the Mesopotamian, it has spread to these countries, so that the kingdoms of that entire region were writing to one another, means these development of writing spread after Mesopotamians to these areas and to the Pharaoh of Egypt. It is a script, you can say, you can, this is a script of Egypt. It is adopted in the Egypt also, means the writing skill was adopted in the language and script of Mesopotamia, correct? So Egypt people, Turkey, Syria, many of the kingdoms, they have adopted the Mesopotamian script. So we, what these scripts, we will tell you. So we will explore the connections between the city life and the writing. Okay, so now you are clear with the topic. So in this we will be mainly reading about the two topics, that will be the city life and the writing, and then look at some of the outcomes of the sustained traditional of writings, means we will be having more deep readings of the writing skills that was developed in this period. Okay, in the beginning of recorded history, when we have started recording this Mesopotamian city, the land, mainly the urbanized south, was called Sumer and Akkad. Correct. So when we talk about the cities, especially the urbanized south, so there were the mainly the areas that was the Sumer and Akkad. Correct. So I have given you more names. It is also, it will be also there. So after 2000 BC, when Babylon came and in independent city, correct. So there were many cities at that time, they emerged. But the thing is that who had the great importance in the history, that were the Babylon, Uruk, and there are four more main cities, that is the Ur and Mari. Okay, we will be having a complete study of these four cities, but by this side we had more cities, that is the Sumer and Akkad. When Babylon became an important city, the term Babylon was used by the southern region. Correct. So now when we talk about these areas, so that was Babylon was used for these cities. For about 1100 BC, when the Persians established their kingdom in the north, the region became known as the Persia. Correct. So the and the places of these names were changed from Persian to Persia in the northern region of these kingdoms. So the first knowledge of language of the land were Sumerian. Okay. So the first language that was developed in these lands were the Sumerians. So it was used by the Sumer. So that is the name it was given for the language was the Sumerian. It was gradually replaced by Akkadian around 2400 BCE when Akkadian speakers arrived. Okay, so it made it more clear with this ki we had more languages than the one. So we had Sumerians and we had Akkadian. So this language flourished till about Alexander's time. Correct. So that shows the language, it spread from 2400 BCE to 323 BCE. From that long period, this language was there. So with some of the regional challenges occurring, so that things were remain in that area. From 14,000 BCE, Arabic also trickled in. So another word is coming, that is the Aramaic. This language, similar to Urdu, became widely spoken after 1000 BCE. It is still spoken in some parts of Iraq. So I hope you understood. It is not a small civilization. It is considered as one of the most biggest civilization in the world. So that we are going to read in this chapter. So when we talk about the archaeologists, they have started survey of these Mesopotamians. It was around 1840s. So at the very beginning, they have searched the two sites, that is Uruk and Mari, which we have talked in the map. Okay, so that archaeologists excavated these two areas for decades, means many years they have searched on these areas, on these cities. We cannot have any projects that is taken in India for a long time. So we can study about the Mesopotamians. They had a great building, statues, ornaments, graves, tools, and seals. So we can see they were having, archaeologists have got many and hundreds of Mesopotamians things from the archaeologist sites. And they have give us a lots of information about the Mesopotamian. Okay, so Mesopotamian is considered as one of the important sites because it has given us one of the oldest testament, which is considered as the first part of the Bible. Okay, so this place, for the Europeans' point, it is important because they have given the first book or first part of the Old Testament, that is the Bible. Okay, so that book has giving the complete reference of the Sumer, that is the meaning of Sumer. It is a land of brick build cities, correct? So when we are talking about these travelers and scholars who were the Europe, looked into the Mesopotamian as an ancient ancestral land, correct? So I hope you understood, because these European people have got the first book of the Bible, that is named as the Old Testament. Okay, so for the European, this place was a important one for them. So when the archaeologists worked to begin in this area, there was an attempt to prove a literal truth about the Old Testament. So they have worked on this for a long years to search about the Bibles. So for the middle 19th century, there was no stopping of enthusiasm for exploring the ancient past. So if you have remembered the date, year, so they have started around in 1840s, and long decades they worked on this. So they don't want to stop because they are exploring the ancient past of the Mesopotamian. So even they have funded the expenditure of the British Museum to search for the tablet which is giving the narrating story of the flood, which is mentioned in the Bible. So here we got the evidences of the Bible, what the Bible says about the flood. According to the Bible, the flood was meant to destroy all the life on the earth. However, God chose a man, Noah, to ensure that life could continue after the flood. Okay, the life is considered, the man is considered as a Noah. So that life continues after the flood also. So Noah built a huge boat, an ark. He took a pair each of all known species of animals and birds. Okay, so he means the man has took the life in a pair, in the form of species like an animals and birds. Correct. So on board the ark which survived the flood, there was a striking similar story in the Mesopotamian tradition. So that's somewhere they have linked with the Bible, this kind of same story that is in the Bible. So that is linking the Mesopotamian with the Bible, where the principal character was Zurudra, that is an Unthopistim. So when we talk about this character is talking about the life of long days, correct? So that is the Bible talking about the flood. By the 1960s, it was understood that the stories of the Old Testaments were not literally true, okay, but may have been ways of expressing memories about the important changes in history. So different historians has different related stories about the Old Testament. So some says it is not literally true. Gradually, archaeologists' techniques became far more sophisticated and refined. So whatever we got, the archaeological evidences that are sophisticated and refined, we have got it. So what is more, attention was directed to different questions, including reconstructing the lives of ordinary people. So how this life generated? So we are having different questions that are still in the archaeologist mind. So establishing the literal truth of biblical narrative relegates into the background. So they have to think according to the Bible's point of view. So all these we will be reading in this chapter. Our next topic is Mesopotamian and its geography. As I made it more clear with this map, so once make you more clear about that, we are having one more map in this topic that is showing you the geographical locations of these places. So I have talked about the two rivers. These are the rivers. So when we are talking about the Mesopotamians, they are between these two rivers, and these areas are known as the steppes. Correct. So beside that, we are having some agricultural land which is giving a good productivity for the people who are living for this. Now, this side you can see we are having the northeast ranges of mountains. So that is completely a mountain ranges. Okay, so when we talk about this red line, this is showing the southern limit of zones of red fed agriculture. It means so these areas are giving us a rain fed agriculture, means till the time there will be a rain, so that is areas will give us a good productions. So Mesopotamian mountains, steppe deserts, irrigated zones of the south. Correct. So I hope you are correct. So when we have talked about the important places, they were the Babylon, they were the Ur, Mari. Okay. And this was the place known as the, we will talk it later on because we have not mentioned this till this topic. So let's start the topic, which is talking about the Mesopotamia and its geography. So as we have talked, Iran is the present land when we talk about Mesopotamia. Iran is a land of diverse environments. In the northeast lies the green, undulating plains, gradually rising to trees-covered mountains, ranges with clear streams and wild flowers. Correct. So with the map, you can see we are having completely northeast, that is a green area showing of the mountain ranges that are covered with the trees and the streams and the flowers. So these are having enough rainfalls to grow crops. So agriculture began around 7000 to 6000 BCE. In the north, there is a stretch of upland, that is the steppes I talked, where animals herding offers people a better livelihood for agriculture. After the winter rains, sheep, goats feed up on the grasses and low shrubs that grow here. So to the next, to the east, Trigis provide routes of communication into the mountains of Iran. Correct. So these are the steppes. So these are having the mountain ranges. When we talk about these mountain ranges, which are moving towards the eastern areas, so they are giving us a good routes communication routes to the mountains of the Iraq. Correct. So when we talk about the south of the desert, see, I talked here, it is a desert. And this is where the first city and writing emerged. Correct. So we will be reading in the coming up topics about the cities and the writings. So this desert could support cities because the river Euphrates and Tigris are there. Okay, just because these are the places between the two rivers support life. which rise in the now northern mountains carry lots of silt because of the mountains. When the river flows from these mountains, it brings the silt, which is a fine mud for the agriculture. When they flood, or when their water is let out on the fields, fertile silt is disported. So we get a good agricultural from this disported silt. So our next topic about this is that after the aphids has entered the deserts, because when we talk about the deserts area, it is just near of that river. So it flows out into small channels. Some channels flood their banks, and in the past functions and irrigated canals. Okay, so this is the location of the rivers. So they, when they are flowing near the deserts area, so they are having a irrigation canals, which make them to have a good production of wheat, barley, peas, and lentils. Lentils is a masoor ki dal, okay, which were necessary for them. So can you imagine from the first chapter to this chapter what much progress we have made in this? So we will be reading more about these system in the next chapter also, that is the Roman Empire. Okay, so this, it was the agriculture of the southern Mesopotamian which was the most productive, even though the regions did not have sufficient rainfall to grow crops, correct? So with the good irrigation canals, they had made this irrigation possible. So no, not only agriculture, so beside that they had the good pastoralized lands for the sheep and the goats in the areas of steppes, which I have talked, it is in the northeastern plains of the mountains, below the mountain slopes, correct? So which having the good river sites and fertile areas. So these animals give them the meat, meal, milk and wool in abundance, so that they can survive their life healthy. So beside that, there is a fish which is available in the rivers, and the date palms give fruits in summer, correct? So let us not, however, make the mistake of thinking what the city grew simply because of rural prosperity. Okay, so that will make it more clear in the coming up topics. I hope you have understood. I will wind up here and I will come with the new topics in my next videos. Till that time, revise and start making the notes. Thank you and have a nice day.